Okay, so now let's look at the memory component of the immune system. We've talked about the B memory B cells and memory T cells, but let's look at it a little bit closer on the response time of first exposure to a pathogen or a foreign antigen and versus subsequent exposures to that one. So you can see how your immune system responds to the second exposure much more efficiently than even the first one. And when we're going through this, think about this in terms of being vaccinated, okay? And again, with this COVID-19 going around, there are early trials of a vaccine for COVID-19, which won't come around for a year or so if it's available at that time, but it gives you an idea of how a vaccine is working in this case. So let's take a look at this. And our first response to a foreign antigen or a pathogen, you don't really have, or you have very limited number of helper T, killer T cells, B cells that really are kicking in at this point. And when you look at it on your first exposure, that leads to the development of your memory B cells and memory T cells. And with the second exposure, the response time is so much quicker that oftentimes the pathogen is destroyed or eliminated even before you have symptoms or know that you've been exposed to something. So let's look at your initial exposure first. And let me bring up this table here that I got out of your book. Okay. So here's your initial exposure, which is going to be on this left-hand side. So this is initial, and this is a subsequent. Those are different exposures. So let's just look at this initial one first, which leads into what is your primary response to the initial exposure. Okay. So on the y-axis, we have the amount of antibodies in your system. The x-axis on the bottom is going to be time. Okay. So those are going to be on day-wise. And the blue column here, that's going to be a lag time. So on your first exposure, what we're looking at is you have your non-specific phagocytic cells that engulf a foreign antigen. It has to then display it to another cell in order for your body to then start its immune response. In your primary or your initial exposure, that lag time can end be anywhere from 3 to 6 days. So during all this time, that pathogen, if it's a virus, can replicate over and over and over on this. And you can see on the bottom here, the two curves, this one and this one, the blue and the red curve, those are only looking at two of the immunoglobulins, IgG, which is the primary one. That's when you have 75 to 85% of those in your body. And then the IgM one as well. So you can see that the antibodies or the plasma cells start to produce antibodies in about 5 days, but at such a low quantity, but they reach their peak within almost about 2 weeks. So you can see for the IgM, that's around 11 days versus IgG, which is 15, 16 days. So a couple weeks before we get to really peak production of the antibodies to then fight off that foreign antigen. But you can also see that the concentration or the quantity of that antibody in your system also rapidly decreases over a couple more weeks until we get down to very low levels once again. Okay, so that's your first exposure. So let's look at your secondary exposure. you can see that your lag time is almost non-existent. It's a day or so, okay? It can be less than a day thereabouts. But you can see that the response time, since you have the memory B cells and memory T cells already set up for this, you can see that, in this case, IgG responds so much more vigorously than your first exposure. So you've got a significant amount of antibodies being produced, and that this knocks off that pathogen long before you even really know you have symptoms, or at worst, very mild symptoms. Okay, so this is really kicking in. The other thing to note, okay, so the peak antibodies on this one, if we were to go down on this roughly, so you're looking about 5 days versus 2 weeks on the other one, okay? The other thing to note is even after about a month time, the levels of immunoglobulins in your system is significantly greater than the level after your first exposure. So you retain those immunoglobulins in your system, IgG in particular, for a much longer time on this. This is helping to develop the immune system. Now, when we look at this, think about a vaccination, okay, for measles. If you have measles, you're vaccinated as a child, that is your initial exposure. And you undergo this primary response. It develops your memory B and memory T cells, okay? No, you're not going to get measles from getting vaccinated from the measles. This is all malarkey on that one, okay? So as the child grows up, let's say they're exposed to measles, okay? They're out in the playground, whatever, and they get exposed to it. You can see how that secondary response is so much more vigorous to it that it knocks it out even before it has a chance to take its foothold. So this is the whole idea with vaccines or being vaccinated on this. So that's it for this one. I guess I was thinking about something else and I forgot. Okay, so the next thing we're gonna do is looking at the differences between the active and passive immunity. And I think that will probably be it. Hopefully, we'll see.